There are 5 million homes in Britain provided at reduced rent through local councils. But 4.5 million people are queuing for them for an average of 7 years.
I'm homeless. I've got no place to go. I've got no one.
These people claim to need emergency housing.
I don't want to wake up again with mice in my house. My priority now is find a place where to stay tonight.
But which of them needs help the most?
The situation is crazy. For you to just wake up one morning and then you're being thrown out of your home.
How have you become homeless? My father kicked me out.
When people come in here, Carol, do they always tell the truth?
No.
I am putting my neck out on the line for you because it's taxpayers' money being used to pay for your accommodation there.
The system will decide which of them gets the help they're looking for.
I'm not fussy, I don't care if it's a tower block, if it's a...
I'm just asking someone to help.
Got some good news. We've got a flat.
Only a few will get a new home.
This is the fact of life. This is what's happening in England. We can't help everyone.
This is the Tower Hamlets Homeless Service.
Theresa Ann Wilton to room 16, please.
It's the accident and emergency department of the housing system.
My house went on fire last night.
God.
My bed went up, my bedroom's just...
Oh, what happened? What?
Like a cheap one from the pan shop.
Oh, God.
3,300 people came here last year, claiming to be in urgent need of a home.
Because I'm homeless, I've got no place to go, basically.
Okay.
I've got no money to go, and if you want, I can sleep here. I don't care. Because I'm homeless.
I accept you're homeless, okay? I fully appreciate where you're coming from, but we don't have a duty to provide you with housing.
Surprisingly, simply being homeless doesn't entitle anyone to help.
Why? Because you do not have a priority need for housing. Now, the priority need groups, which you do not fall into, is a person who has responsibility for children, a woman who is pregnant...
Local councils have a legal duty to find housing for some people, but only if they fall into a priority group.
Also, a person who is suffering from severe mental or physical disability. You do not fall into that category. We have no responsibility to provide you with housing. The law is the law.
I mean, you walk in thinking that you're going to get a council house. You may obviously, on 9 times out of 10, you leave without that being achieved. We spend a lot of our time saying no.
There are no council homes available for emergency allocation. Those who qualify for rehousing can join the waiting list, where they will wait for an average of 7 years. The only immediate option available is accommodation rented from private landlords. The council have to compete for these properties on the open market, and the cheapest cost about 3 times what a council home would.
Amanda Duhati to room 16.
A team of housing officers determine who does qualify for these properties.
Amanda Duhati, room 16, please.
Their first job is to listen to the story to see if it adds up.
I was working like a slave, doing 3 jobs. That was just everything at once happened, seriously, and I just got up and I left. I walked out of the property, and pretty much since then, I've been wandering.
Amanda abandoned her previous flat, but now she hopes that her teenage son's situation will persuade Council Officer Tayo to give her another one.
Where has your son been staying?
He's staying in a cupboard.
What do you mean a cupboard?
A cupboard, that's where his bed is, in a cupboard in my daughter's flat.
Well, she's gone flat?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yes, yeah. It's 2 bedrooms, but her son's in 1 bedroom, she's in another, he's in a cupboard.
Why can't he stay in the living room?
Because it's just not viable. Him being hit by a bus.
Was hit by a bus?
Yeah, he needs to be flat on his back.
Because of the accident?
Yes, yeah.
That's not nice.
No.
So if I open the door to that flat?
You'll find him in the cupboard.
In the cupboard?
Yes, it's a cupboard.
The council officers take nothing at face value. Tayo goes to share the unusual details of the case with Carol, his boss.
A 16-year-old son, he had an accident. He was hit by a bus in January. And at the moment, he's sleeping in the cupboard in his sister's flat. It's not adding up. That's one that I want to look at properly.
Yeah, make sure, because confirm. It's
a bit of an
awkward
one.
Well, I've not heard that one before.
Yeah.
When people come in here, Carol, do they always tell the truth?
No. They do a lot, though. But there are a few. I suppose some of the truth is stretched, some is hidden, and there are some outright lies.
Next morning, Tayo is going to find out whether Amanda's son is really living in a cupboard.
I was just thinking, what am I going to find there today? Would it be she has misled us, or could it be a situation where she really is serious? Hi, how are you?
Sorry.
Yeah. Where is your son?
He's asleep at the moment, but yeah, you can.
Okay. What's this?
It's a cupboard.
Storage room or something.
Yeah.
Right. It makes more sense now. Mm. You know, what is going on? Mm. Before Nikki's accident, Nikki was staying here, wasn't he?
No, he was staying everywhere. Here, there, everywhere. I left him. I went. I make no bones about that. I made a mistake and I left, okay? Now I'm just asking someone to help. All I want is a second chance to sort my son out with that. Feeling like I'm some sort of beggar.
That's fine. If you could make your way to be for 12 o'clock this afternoon.
12 o'clock.
Yeah, I'll be happy to see you at 12 o'clock.
I'll see you there.
Bye.
Well, not quite what I thought, but I think she's right. No windows, ventilation seems to be a problem. So I don't think it's an ideal place for him to stay in. So I'd want to progress this as quickly as possible.
The council will now offer Amanda emergency accommodation. Families with dependent children are always assessed as having priority need.
The situation is crazy. That's the only word I can use. Well, we've done almost all the packing. Right now, we're homeless.
Georgina, Glenn, and their newborn baby, Anaya, are about to be evicted from their housing association property.
The famous court order. The court ordered that, one, the defendant give the claimant possession of the flat, which is the flat I'm living in. And then the defendant paid the claimant their cost of £175. They're taking the £175 from the poor man.
Homelessness? No. It's not anybody. It's not anything I'd wish anybody to go through.
Glenn Obasaiko, room 18.
Glenn has come to the council for help.
Afternoon, Glenn.
Good afternoon.
I'm Salma, one of the housing options officers. Okay, how can we help you?
I had an issue with my landlords. They wrote to me and gave me a notice to vacate from the flat. Then the courts give them a possession order.
Oh, the courts actually granted that possession.
Glenn and his girlfriend think they have the right to live in the flat, but the landlord says Glenn's ex-wife is the tenant and they must get out.
So any help I can get, because I don't end up much money. Okay. So I need social housing.
If you just bear with me one moment.
Yes.
Thank you. I have a gentleman in. He's come in with a possession order.
Why are they evicting him?
What's happened is he moved in with his wife. It's a sole tenancy query.
Hang on a sec. It was her tenancy.
Yeah.
Where's the tenant?
The tenant is in room 18.
No, where's the wife, the tenant?
The wife.
He's not the tenant.
She left him in 2006.
If it doesn't feel right, it probably isn't right. Do you ever get that feeling? You think, what's wrong? What's going on? Yeah. So what dates have we got?
Glenn's story is somewhat confusing.
Have we got his wife's phone number? Well, let's give her a ring and get the story from her.
So Carol makes a call to try to find out the truth.
Hello,
My name's Carol Johnson from the Homeless Service. Hi, I wonder if you could give us a bit of help here. I'm calling regarding the property that used to be your tenancy on the Isle of Dogs. I understand you left the property some years ago, and he lived there. Right, 2 years, okay. And you bought a property, and where was that? Is the house in your name in Kent? I appreciate that. Bye-bye. He's a joint owner of a house in Kent.
Glenn is claiming to be homeless, but he can't be if he owns a property.
It's a criminal offence to try and gain accommodation from the local authority by the use of false information. So that's against the law.
If Carol is right, Glenn can be prosecuted.
We're just taking back over the story, and hopefully he'll give it to us straight this time.
Glenn says that he and his family are being evicted from their flat and have nowhere else to go. But Carol thinks he might be lying. She has evidence that he already owns a house outside London.
The story is they both bought a house in Kent.
If this is true, he's committed fraud, and the council could prosecute.
We'll just get him to sign, take him back over the story, and hopefully he'll give it to us straight this time. Hello, Mr. Obasaka. My name's Carol Johnson. Before we start, we would like you to sign a declaration regarding the information that you're giving us.
Okay.
It's actually a criminal offence to attempt to get accommodation from a local authority by using false information. Okay, so it's not just a misdemeanour, it's a criminal offence. Okay, where's your wife live?
In Kent.
Is it owned?
It's a house.
Right, who owns it?
She.
So she's the sole owner?
That's correct.
I ask you that because we've spoken to her and she says it's jointly owned. Is that correct?
No, it's not.
Right. So we're going to go and do a land registry search on that now.
That's fine.
It takes us about 10 minutes.
That's fine.
Are you going to be on the land registry as the owner?
Well, I'm not.
Because, to be honest, she sounds quite plausible and you sound quite plausible.
I'm not.
It is important to us because we don't want to give someone assistance with housing who owns a property. Can you imagine?
I can't understand.
Did you or did you not sign a document?
I can't remember. Yeah, I'll be sure.
You won't be?
I won't be, yeah.
You might be an owner of this property, you don't know.
I don't know.
Salma orders records from the land registry to find out who owns the house.
I would say you're not the owner. You're not on here. I'm sorry if you feel you've been accused of something incorrectly. I'm very sorry about that.
No, that's fine.
Your wife was perfectly clear that you owned it, so we had to look into that.
Because Glenn doesn't own another property, Carol now wants to prevent the eviction.
Is there any way at all you think there's any case to save the tenancy? He's been there since 2004 or so.
If she can't do this, the council will have to find him somewhere else to live. And securing affordable private flats is very hard. Tell him you've got it or you haven't. Last year, London councils were forced to house 4,000 people in bed and breakfasts at a cost of £80 million. Lisa and her boyfriend Darren are two of the council's most regular customers. They are both currently accommodated in separate hotel rooms.
Show me your feet, come on. A little bit. Go on. Oh, I love him, I swear
it's
I love
hurting,
him.
Man. No, it's hurting, Bubba.
I love you, Joanna.
You're Darren's
social worker.
Yeah.
Oh, no problem.
Can I speak to you?
Lisa spends a lot of her time managing council business for them both.
OK, 1 minute. That's the only way you can get my eyes done.
Hello? Who am I talking to?
Your social worker.
Chuck! 1 second.
You forget all the time.
Please be quiet. Stop talking. Is this the woman now going to have the interview, the assessment?
Staring.
But today, Lisa is dealing with her own case. After years in and out of hostels and bed and breakfasts, she's hoping to convince the council to give her a flat.
It ain't going to be permanent accommodation. Hopefully it'll be temporary and then permanent from now. But temporary could be up to 5 years, but at least I'm in a place of my own, got my own key to my own front door and not an hostel. I'd be happy.
Lisa is claiming that a medical condition means she should be considered a priority case.
Are you ready for me? Not you, sweetheart.
Lisa Page, she's been coming, she's been in and out of here for years.
She's got a character, sir. She's a nice person.
Vince has just received her doctor's report, but it doesn't suggest she's in priority need.
I think she's got mental health issues because her behaviour has been questionable on many occasions when she's attended here, and her doctor made no reference to it. It's not for us to then make a determination based on what she says.
It just comes down to the medical. It all comes down to that. And if you're in priority, obviously we have to accommodate you and provide you temporary accommodation. If you're not, council has no duty.
The report means Lisa doesn't qualify. Vince now has to give her the news.
Yeah, 1 second.
Okay.
Yeah, cool. Okay.
Thank you.
You okay?
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Mr. Rose. I'm the housing options team leader. I'm Tariq's manager. Based on this information, coupled with all the other information we have on your file, we have to make a decision if we feel you fall within a priority need group. And that decision is that you're not in priority need. So that means that the council has no long-term duty to provide you with accommodation. Should it be the case that you have been diagnosed with a mental illness and you are receiving treatment, then obviously if you can provide us with that information, then we will reconsider your application for housing. We still have to give you a reasonable period in your bed and breakfast to enable you to find alternative accommodation. So what we will actually do is give you a further 14 days extra in B&B to give you reasonable time to try and find alternative accommodation.
I can't believe that. They turned me to drink.
Lisa now has 2 weeks to produce a new letter from her doctor. Without it, she's no hope of being given a permanent home. Many of those who come here want immediate rehousing.
My priority now is find a place where to stay tonight.
The council must determine who is homeless and who is not.
And I'm living in a flat with mice. I have mice infestation. Poo everywhere, on kitchen towels, everywhere.
Leah says she has a mouse infestation and she can't take her newborn baby home.
Enjoy.
This morning.
Fresh. This is still there. Look. Look. Did try to escape, and it was disgusting to take from the floor.
She's a very capable person. She's got a serious problem, but we don't believe it renders her homeless. We don't believe she's an emergency. We're not saying it's nice. We're saying you can live there while you sort it out. OK? And so I'll leave that to you.
Thank you very much.
I'm sorry. The only input we could do is to go and liaise with the landlord and try to resolve the mice infestation.
So you guys are deaf. This is an ongoing issue, ongoing.
With certain decisions, it's a matter of common sense, isn't it? Are you able to reside in a property with a certain level of infestation? Yes, you are. So as far as being statutory homeless goes, she's not. One mouse can't mean that everyone's whisked out. We'd have a queue around the block, wouldn't we?
Nearly 9 out of 10 of those who make applications here will not be provided with a new home.
Naomi Livingstone, 2 room 16. I've got a police report here. My
ex-partner kicked off my front door. I woke up and he had his hands around my throat. He'd bit into my face. It really takes a lot to frighten me, but I don't want to go back to that for that.
Naomi has run away from the home she shares with her two children.
Okay. Obviously, you can't go back there. So if you just give me a few minutes, I will go and speak to the team. No, you okay waiting in here? I'll be 2 minutes. Yeah, wait. Okay.
Oh. Right. Oh. From the way I sense, it's definitely we have to look into taking her away from that property.
So we spoke to the police?
Yeah. I mean, she's a bit emotional as we speak, so
We need to give her options. Let me have a quick word with her. What room is she in?
16.
Because domestic violence is involved, the council must find Naomi a place to stay tonight.
A couple of things I want to go over with you. Firstly, you're at your mum's, but he knows where you are. How safe are you there?
At Berwick.
Right, OK.
But
so
safer than I am at my flat.
Right. With property in such short supply, all that's on offer is bed and breakfast.
There is this shortage of property at the moment. Just want a place of safety for me and my children. Of course you do. You can't do anything if you don't.
I'm not fussy. Just do anything.
Okay.
But something private that I can take them in and even use the excuse that we've just moved, or, you know, mummy bidded on this and we got a flat, or.
Yeah. But, I mean, the hotel is obviously going to be difficult. You are sharing facilities.
Naomi is worried about moving her children into a bed and breakfast. So Carol and Antonia agree to attempt to find her a flat.
Hi, good morning.
Hi, it's Carol Johnson from Tower Hamlets Families Options. Hi, we're keen to get someone viewing your property.
I just wanted to know if they're just B&B you've got today, or have you got any flats?
She's had a very bad experience, and we wanted to try and avoid hotels.
Finding cheap property at short notice is almost impossible. The only option is to call estate agents in the hope that one of them might help.
Yeah.
Thanks a lot. Bye-bye. It's regarding my client.
Okay.
Against the odds, it looks like Antonia may have found somewhere.
Is it still available?
Oh, wow.
Okay. Yeah.
Ouch.
But there's a catch.
Thank you so much for your help.
Oh. They're looking for a letter.
Problem. Carol, they're saying what incentive are we going to pay?
1 month's rent, a cap of 1,200. So that's.
Because most homeless people don't have the money for a deposit, the council offers landlords a cash incentive instead.
If you give me his number, I'll give him a ring.
0207.
On this occasion, Carol's been given authority to offer up to £2,000.
It's a very nice family. It's a mum with two girls, and, you know, we highly recommend them. She should be a nice tenant. Will you do it for £2,000? Right. OK. Well, if... Thank you. Thanks. The landlord will definitely not take any money under
£2,500. Ouch.
Antonia will have to break the news that they can only offer a B&B.
But it's like there's so much on you now that you're having to think about this.
Yeah, I'll wait with Mum. I can't take my kids to a B&B. But thank you for your help.
It's all right.
Naomi will stay at her mother's while the council keeps searching for a flat.
Good walk, Neil. Well done. Feet nice and straight. That's lovely.
Tony's son Alex is 23 and has cerebral palsy. For the past few years, Alex has lived with Tony. But this morning, all that's about to change.
I don't know what sort of place they're going to be able to offer you, Al. If you're lucky, they might put you in a five-star hotel with a sauna.
Tony has come to the council in order to evict his son.
Sonny Chung, room 16, please. OK, so are you evicting him?
Yeah, I'm evicting today.
Today?
Today.
Okay, I might... Okay, we can go back there.
This isn't the first time that Alex and Tony have been here, but it seems that today, things have come to a head.
Alex has been going through a tough time with his disability. He was getting drunk regularly, calls every other day from the police saying, like, he's with them drunk. And it's put me under pressure a bit, I suppose. But I've told him I'll be seeing him every day, even if he does get, if they house him on his own, I'll still be around for him.
He's evicting him today.
Will he actually take him home while suitable accommodation is found?
He said no to that about this.
Right, okay. Oh, hi, just making sure you're there. We've got the gentleman with the boy with cerebral palsy in. Stephen's coming up to discuss it with you. See you then, bye.
Yeah, yeah, cheers.
Application for assistance under the Housing Act, 1996 Part 7, homelessness. Who advised you to apply as homeless, my father? How have you become homeless? My father kicked me out.
Simply turned up to say, look, I'm evicting him today.
I need to speak to David regarding this case.
David, the family turned up this morning.
He just told me, he's made clear that he's not going back home with Alex, the son, today.
Right.
I know it seems drastic, but I'm kind of like panicking a bit, you know? If I put pressure on them, get Alex housed, at least he'll be okay.
Tony and Alex Chung, room 16, please.
Hello, Alex.
Hi.
How are you?
Fine.
Good. Hi, Tony. What's going on then?
Well.
Can we open that a bit for me?
Okay.
How do you open that? I can't.
Yeah,
see
if you I thought
know. I'm evicting my son.
In terms of your decision about evicting Alex today, it's not as simple as that. Even if you evict Alex, I need social services to be more involved at the moment. They need to convince us that they're going to be providing all the support they can for Alex, because the type of accommodation we provide to most homeless families, I don't think that's going to be suitable for Alex for the time being.
So what will you do, leave him out on the street?
So
you can't, by law, leave me on the street.
No, you're not going to go on the street. That's one thing for sure. You're not going to go on the street today. We just need to know what type of accommodation is suitable for you.
How long will that take?
That will take about 2 or 3 days.
Eventually, Tony agreed to take Alex back home.
It may be a cry for help, basically. It's come too late now. I can't cope. And the only way you're going to listen to me, I dump my son on your doorstep, you'd have to do, and we can't let Alex on the street. No, we will ever do that. It's all very well for us. We can walk away from here tonight and go home. As much as Alex is lovable, but he must be a handful when you're having 24/7, isn't it? He's not a young baby, you can hold on to him, a toddler. He's quite a big lad, isn't he?
Let's carry you over. Anyway, wait, car coming.
Okay.
Alex and Tony will return in 3 days in the hope that the council will have found somewhere suitable for Alex to live. Lisa has less than 2 weeks left in her bed and breakfast, and she still hasn't got the letter from her doctor to prove that she's a priority case. But today, her mind's on other things.
Look, bears, they're beautiful. But there's the one, boyfriend, gorgeous, that's the one with the ears, lovely. And look at the little bears, look. It's nice, look, there's that one or that one, they're beautiful.
Lisa and Darren have been together for 8 years, but there aren't any hostels for homeless couples, and they've never shared a home.
Spare little change, sir.
Lisa's regularly been provided with accommodation, but everywhere she's been given, she's lost.
Spare little change, please. The first ever place I got was a hotel, the Viking Motel it was called, along Romford Road. From now, Balderson Point, Canning Town. From Canning Town, I had West Ham Lane. From West Ham Lane. Shit, what happened there? From West Ham Lane, I had Chris Street Market. From there, I was 36 Augusta Street. From there, Barking Road it was. From there, they've put me into Hope Town. From Hope Town, they put me back into the Shuttleworth. That's 9 places, really. So I've messed myself up, really. Spare a little change, please.
Lisa will only get the flat she's hoping for if she can prove she's a priority case.
I love you.
I need to sit down, you know. I need to go and sit.
Come in. Okay, come in. Yeah, come on. I'd rather be rehearsed together, Darren. What I think is, now I'm on the tower remnants, I'm going to ask them if they can rehouse me and you together.
Yeah.
If I can put you on my tenancy.
They won't do with me.
Why can't they put you on my tenancy?
Well, you ask them. Then
because
you go
I want
forward.
You around me all the time.
I'll be with you.
You ain't going to come down and see me every day, Darren.
I'll be down with you. I'll stay down here if I have to, somewhere, even if I have to sleep in the street. I will live.
Lisa and Darren are staying in separate bed and breakfasts. The rules say they must spend the night in their own room. Alone. The next morning, Lisa is back at the housing office. Her bed and breakfast booking has been unexpectedly cancelled.
One second, please. I'm not having a W, but there's nothing you can do about it.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Let me explain something to you that you need to understand, right? Because it's like you don't understand, because it's the second time this has happened, right? We offer you bed and breakfast accommodation because you tell us you have nowhere to go, right? Keep that in mind. That means that you are supposed to be using that bed and breakfast accommodation every night without fail, because it's taxpayers' money being used to pay for your accommodation there. If you do not use it, what does that tell us? That tells us that you ain't homeless, that you don't need accommodation. Now, this is the second time this has happened. Now, I'm going to authorise your booking to go back for the final time. If you do not stay at that hotel during this period, when you're supposed to, we will not be providing you with any further accommodation.
Okay.
Because we're supposed to do that after the first time you've done it. This is the second time you've done it. So I am putting my neck out on the line for you. And I'm not going to do it again. Okay?
Yeah.
All right? So you take a seat and I'll get your casework to sort it out.
All right, thank you.
What about the letter you're going to get bring from your doctors?
Yeah, tomorrow, as I said to him, I'm going to get the letter from
and
there.
And bring
it
here? Yeah. Every night at that hotel?
I will be.
Okay.
Thank you, Vince.
Okay. Naomi is back at the housing office. After being attacked by an ex-partner, she's waiting for the council to find her a new home. Rather than take her children to live in a bed and breakfast, she's chosen to stay at her mother's. And her mother has called Antonia to share her concerns.
Yeah, all right, thanks a lot. Mum's really scared for her. Mum says she doesn't mind having Naomi pending something in terms of rehousing her. But the issue is he knows her address. So Naomi needs to get away.
Naomi will have to go into a bed and breakfast after all. Unless Antonia can find somewhere else.
Hi, good morning. My name's Antonia Begg. I'm calling from Tower Hamlets Housing Options. I've got a client that's ready to move in today, like as we speak. Is it still available? Okay, bye-bye. Naomi Livingstone, 2 room 16. Naomi Livingstone, 2 room 16.
Hi, Naomi. How are you?
I don't know how I am.
Don't worry. We can actually offer you something today.
That's just the best news ever. Sorry.
I feel like I've won the lottery.
Sorry.
All right.
Thank
Okay.
No problem. I'll get you her details up.
Thank you so much.
Naomi has been lucky. It's rare for the council to find a private flat so fast.
But I tell you, it's not over because she might come back and say she hates it. You know, or something like that. You never know. So we'll wait and see.
The property came just at the right time, you know, because initially I was looking, well, we've got no other option but to put you into B&B until something comes up. I know that's not what you want, but that's what we'd have to do. But fortunately, today, the property came.
I feel like clicking my heels together.
Naomi will now go to view the property to decide whether it's suitable as a new family home.
Your toothbrush is ready, Al.
Yeah.
Tony is returning to the council in the hope that they've found Alex a suitable home.
I spoke to Noella, and she reckons that there aren't any places available, but I don't believe that. This is kind of tiring me out, you know. What I'm fearing is that the housing people are trying to get me to keep Alex. It's just impossible.
Tony and Alex Chung, room 16, please.
Hello, I'm Leighton. I've got some good news.
Uh-huh.
We've got Alex a flat. And it's on the ground floor, and it's in the borough as well.
Great.
You will be in the property on your own, but social services will be coming to see you.
Okay.
Alex can now go to view the property. Tony is hopeful it will be what they both need.
I mean, sooner or later, he will need to be as independent as possible, and the place he'll be going to, they're going to give him the skills to be independent, and that's going to benefit him a lot. It'll give him a lot of confidence.
So, yeah, I'm pleased for you, you know.
Lisa's hoping today that she too will be offered a property.
Mickey's.
I love you. Wish me luck, yeah?
See you in a minute, all right?
I'll get for you later. Her 2-week deadline is up.
I love you. Wish me luck, yeah? Good man. See you in a minute, all right? And be careful for your legs, yeah?
Lisa's still hoping that the council can be persuaded to offer her a flat of her own. She's been given until today to bring in a letter from her doctor to confirm she's in priority need. But Tarek has been reviewing Lisa's housing history, and what he's found won't help Lisa's case.
There's going to be a large sum of arrears put on her account because of all the previous times that she was accommodated and she never paid.
How much is she looking at?
About 14 grand. Which is a lot of money, which not many clients, I don't think I've ever seen with that much amount. As far as council accommodation, it's a big issue because it just shows that she can't sustain a tenancy, one. Secondly, I'm pretty sure that at that time she did get evicted because of her rent arrears, so that makes her intentionally homeless. That means that she became homeless of her own accord.
Anyone who is judged responsible for making themselves homeless is automatically disqualified from being rehoused by the council. So even if she has a report from her doctor, Lisa has no chance of being given her own home.
That's what it means. Yeah. Lovely. All right. I'm going to have the exciting job of explaining that to her. Let me call her in. I'll just call her in. Here, Lisa.
Yeah.
Hey.
I'm okay, but not too good.
Where's the report?
I went to the doctor's called Gold. When I go to the doctor's? Last week I went to the doctor's.
She ain't sent it to me.
Fuck them bollocks.
Yeah.
I will deal with it.
All right, you speak
and
to them.
I will give that to you.
All right.
I want a copy.
Let's get to the next point.
Don't pay for nothing.
The next point is, do you know how much a razor is?
About £8,000, isn't it?
It's not £8,000, it's £14,000.
It's 14?
It's £14,000.
All right, I thought it was eight. Okay.
What that kind of shows is that you can't sustain a tenancy on your own. Mm.
Darren's in Finsbury Park. Can't you put me with
I can't
him?
Put you nothing with Darren.
Can't you put
Darren...
us together?
No,
why?
I can't.
Can I ask
Darren...
you a question? Why is that?
Why you can't?
Because I'm helping him. Why can't
right,
you put
I'll
us
you,
together,
firstly,
please?
Darren's case and your case is two separate issues, yeah?
Okay.
Because that's a separate case. At the moment, we're just dealing with your issues.
Can I say something, please?
The referral
for? Darren.
That's what the referral's for. But I told you that I can't even get into the Darren thing right now. As it stands, you don't have no priority for council accommodation. That's not going to be an option.
Why
because
can't I be
I told you, last time I told you, time before that, and I'm going to tell you again.
I love you, darling, and I won't never leave you, you know that.
You can't give someone their own accommodation that has extremely high drug needs and support needs and alcohol needs and mental health needs because they just couldn't sustain it.
Tony is taking Alex to view the privately rented bedsit he's being offered.
This looks like a... No, it's not. Okay.
Bit of a walk, but the exercise will do you good. Oh, wow. Oh, wow. Alex, what have they given you here?
The rent on this bedsit is £240 a week.
Your own shower?
It'll be paid for from Alex's benefits.
Look at this. I can cook you pizzas. This is your living room bedroom, Al. When they said to me you've got a bedsit, I was expecting a pokey little room.
Don't like it. Can't you stay? He left me.
You just don't want to be alone.
Don't fucking make me angry. Don't want ever live by myself.
Naomi Livingstone, 2 room 16.
That is for you. Oh no, don't say that. It's only tiny, but it's just a little token of my appreciation to you.
Naomi is now settled in the private flat that Antonia found. But Antonia can't accept Naomi's chocolates as it would breach council rules.
Thank you, ever so much.
See ya, bye.
The rent on this flat is £185 a week and housing benefit covers most of the cost.
See, it's a nice, cosy little flat. This is the first bedroom. Well, I suppose bedroom number two by inventory, but the children's room. Yeah, the bathroom. This is where we've mainly put our mark. Well, pink rugs. When I walked in here, it was the biggest state in the world, and I cried out of happiness, you know, like, because... I just thought, I'm so lucky. At that particular moment, I was in such a situation that just a place of safety was my main priority. For me, they've made a good decision. You know, this has just given me the bit of oomph that I needed to even sort of not give up. It's given me a new lease of life.
Everybody's life starts from
a roof over their head. That is their foundation. Everything bounces from that. Employment bounces from that. Family life bounces from that. Your future bounces from a foundation. If you don't have a roof over your head, you're kind of lost.
Alex moved to a different flat, one with support on site. Amanda and her son were offered hotel accommodation, but she turned it down. And Glenn is still waiting to find out if a court will overturn the decision to evict his family from the flat.
A roof over your head is central and one of the most important things in order for you to build a life. So when you're telling somebody that you can't give them accommodation, it's never easy because you know what that means.
Vince persuaded another hostel to accommodate Lisa on the condition she addresses her drinking.
As it stands, we don't have a legal duty to provide you with housing. But I'm not going to close the door on you. Okay. I'm going to give you an opportunity. So basically, you have the power. All you've got to do now is show me that you want to help yourself.
Look, I'm running both ways, man. Have you drink yourself to death?
What are you talking about?
I just told you, there's your drink.
Sure.
Yeah.
You're not supposed to be in the building together.
Oh, I'll go out of way, is it?
You're yeah. Definitely not supposed to be drinking, OK?
Well, so I'm not taking
that. Please right. Stop now.
Support information for the issues raised can be found online at channel4.com/support. Now, if you like Gossip Mags, you'll know something about the band. But how much do you know about the fans? Crazy About One Direction is coming up next on 4.
There are 5 million homes in Britain provided at reduced rent through local councils. But 4.5 million people are queuing for them for an average of 7 years.
I'm homeless. I've got no place to go. I've got no one.
These people claim to need emergency housing.
I don't want to wake up again with mice in my house. My priority now is find a place where to stay tonight.
But which of them needs help the most?
The situation is crazy. For you to just wake up one morning and then you're being thrown out of your home.
How have you become homeless? My father kicked me out.
When people come in here, Carol, do they always tell the truth?
No.
I am putting my neck out on the line for you because it's taxpayers' money being used to pay for your accommodation there.
The system will decide which of them gets the help they're looking for.
I'm not fussy. I don't care if it's a tower block, if it's a...
Yeah. I'm just asking someone to help.
Got some good news. We've got a flat.
Only a few will get a new home.
This is the fact of life. This is what's happening in England. We can't help everyone.
This is the Tower Hamlets Homeless Service.
Theresa Ann Wilton to room 16, please.
It's the Accident and Emergency Department of the Housing System.
My ass went on fire last night.
God.
My bed went up, my bedroom's just...
Oh, what happened? What?
Like a cheap one from the pan shop.
Oh, God.
3,300 people came here last year, claiming to be in urgent need of a home.
Because I'm homeless, I've got no place to go, basically.
Okay.
I've got no money to go, and if you want, I can sleep here. No, I don't care, because I'm homeless.
I accept you're homeless, okay? I fully appreciate where you're coming from, but we don't have a duty to provide you with housing.
Surprisingly, simply being homeless doesn't entitle anyone to help.
Why? Because you do not have a priority need for housing. Now, the priority need groups, which you do not fall into, is a person who has responsibility for children, a woman who is pregnant...
Local councils have a legal duty to find housing for some people, but only if they fall into a priority group.
Also, a person who is suffering from severe mental or physical disability. You do not fall into that category. We have no responsibility to provide you with housing. The law is the law.
I mean, you walk in thinking that you're going to get a council house. You may obviously, 9 times out of 10, you leave without that being achieved. We spend a lot of our time saying no.
There are no council homes available for emergency allocation. Those who qualify for rehousing can join the waiting list, where they will wait for an average of 7 years. The only immediate option available is accommodation rented from private landlords. The council have to compete for these properties on the open market, and the cheapest cost about 3 times what a council home would.
Amanda Duhati, to room 16.
A team of housing officers determine who does qualify for these properties.
Amanda Duhati, room 16, please.
Their first job is to listen to the story to see if it adds up.
I was working like a slave, doing 3 jobs. That was just everything at once happened, seriously, and I just got up and I left. I walked out of the property, and pretty much since then, I've been wandering.
Amanda abandoned her previous flat, but now she hopes that her teenage son's situation will persuade council officer Tayo to give her another one.
Where has your son been staying?
He's staying in a cupboard.
What do you mean a cupboard?
A cupboard. That's where his bed is, in a cupboard in my daughter's flat.
Well, she's gone flat.
Yeah. Okay. Yes, yeah. It's 2 bedrooms, but her son's in 1 bedroom, she's in another, he's in a cupboard.
Why can't he stay in the living room?
Because it's just not viable. Him being hit by a bus.
Was hit by a bus?
Yeah. He needs to be flat on his back.
Because of the accident?
Yes, yeah.
That's not nice.
No.
So if I open the door to that flat?
You'll find him in the cupboard.
In the cupboard?
Yes, it's a cupboard.
The council officers take nothing at face value. Tayo goes to share the unusual details of the case with Carol, his boss.
A 16-year-old son, he had an accident. He was hit by a bus in January. And at the moment, he's sleeping in the cupboard in his sister's flat. It's not adding up. That's one that I want to look at properly.
Yeah, make sure, because confirm. It's
a bit of an
awkward
one.
Well, I've not heard
one.
That one before.
Yeah.
When people come in here, Carol, do they always tell the truth?
No. They do a lot, though. But there are a few. I suppose some of the truth is stretched, some is hidden, and there are some outright lies.
Next morning, Tayo is going to find out whether Amanda's son is really living in a cupboard.
I was just thinking, what am I going to find there today? Would it be she has misled us, or could it be a situation where she really is serious? Hi, how are you?
Sorry.
Yeah. Where is your son?
He's asleep at the moment, but yeah, you can.
Okay. What's this?
It's a cupboard.
Storage room or something?
Yeah.
Right. It makes more sense now. Mm. You know, what is going on? Mm. Before Nikki's accident, Nikki was staying here, wasn't he?
No, he was staying everywhere. Here, there, everywhere. I left him. I went. I make no bones about that. I made a mistake and I left, okay? Now I'm just asking someone to help. All I want is a second chance to sort my son out without feeling like I'm some sort of beggar.
That's fine. If you could make your way to be for 12 o'clock this afternoon.
12 o'clock.
Yeah, I'll be happy to see you at 12 o'clock.
I'll see you there.
Bye. Well, not quite what I thought, but I think she's right. No windows, ventilation seems to be a problem, so I don't think it's an ideal place for him to stay in. So I'd want to progress this as quickly as possible.
The council will now offer Amanda emergency accommodation. Families with dependent children are always assessed as having priority need.
The situation is crazy. That's the only word I can use. Well, we've done almost all the packing. Right now, we're homeless.
Georgina, Glenn, and their newborn baby, Anaya, are about to be evicted from their housing association property.
The famous court order. The court ordered that, one, the defendant give the claimant possession of the flat, which is my, the flat I'm living in. And then the defendant paid the claimant their cost of £175. They're taking the £175 from the poor man.
Homelessness? No, it's not anybody. It's not anything I'd wish anybody to go through.
Glenn Obasaiko, room 18.
Glenn has come to the council for help.
Afternoon, Glenn.
Good afternoon.
I'm Salma, one of the housing options officers. Okay, how can we help you?
I had an issue with my landlords. They wrote to me and gave me a notice to vacate from the flat. Then the courts give them a possession order.
Oh, the courts actually granted that possession.
Right.
Glenn and his girlfriend think they have the right to live in the flat. But the landlord says Glenn's ex-wife is the tenant and they must get out.
So any help I can get, because I don't earn that much money. Okay. So I need social housing.
Just bear with me one moment. Just... Thank you. I have a gentleman in. He's come in with a possession order.
Why are they evicting him?
What's happened is he moved in with his wife.